Hey, it's the Chief Binding with Board Games and RPGs. This is a review of Assault Red Horizon 41. This is a tactical World War II game, Russian Front, 1941, Sub Barbarossa, and tactical meaning squad and platoon level troops going at it on visible terrain tiles with elevation and line of sight issues. And we're going to talk about a very cool dice system, which I've never seen with a tactical system, along with, and I just lost one of my command points, cards that will explain very quickly and easily what dice to be rolled in defense and attack. And we're going to go in and dial in and show you some of this now. All right, we're in looking closer. Now, we're going to come in and look at these dice down at the bottom and these cards in a little bit. But first, if you have not seen my unboxing, there are 9 very big double-sided terrain boards. You can see the 2 that are down on the map. You've got a very nice scenario book that's going to give you single-shot games that are very quick, very easy to set up and get playing. I have not gone in and played any of the campaign games yet, but you will start with a particular unit in 1941, Barbarossa, whether you're on the Russian side or the German side, and then you will play through a series of campaigns that put you in time and space. You will have 2 of these nice little helper aids. This particular side will explain the attack and defense dice and ranged fire. This is when you're on the attack. This side is when you're in the defense. And there's a lot of other little rules in here that you'll be referring to make sure you're not missing some of the nuances of the game. All of your terrain. Can you move through the terrain? What does it cost you to move through the terrain? Does the terrain offer you some cover from being shot? Does it give you some concealment from even being spotted? There's tons and tons of optional rules in the game. So first thing being said, this is 2 map boards that are laid out just to show you how they connect. I'm going to go through a few little simple things real quick. So first of all, you have command cards. I'm not going to explain every single command card in here. These basically will break what the standard rules are and give you a lot of fog of war. In this case, tactical training. First, you can use the card anytime. Also tells you this is for the Germans. And this down here, the silhouettes tell you it's usable with armor, AT guns, or infantry. And a friendly unit gets an additional yellow defense die when attacked in ranged fire. So I get attacked. The guy thinks, oh, I know exactly what dice he's going to get in defense. I go ahead and play this card, and now I pick up an extra yellow die that I'll roll in defense. Again, we're going to get to those dice in a bit. So there's a whole slew of these. Some are particular for just the Russians. Some are particular for just the Germans. And then you've got these other set that are cut in half, random, and then divvied half and half into each of the 2 decks. You also have, and I'm going to dial in on these chits real quick. So these chits are going to just quickly allow me to show you some things that you can do. You can fire and move. So you're firing and then moving. So you would lay that down. The flip side would be you could move and then fire. You can be dug in. Now, the cool thing is, in order to get dug in, you first have to order your units to dig in. And they're at a little bit of risk while they do that. But once they do, the little shield symbol here means they're going to get an extra green die if someone attacks them. There's normal action, so you're going to just put that down and you did a normal action. You might have a delayed action based on some things going on in the game. You could have a fast action, which is troops. Your foot troops might end up moving, or they can move an extra hex. You could also play that on an armor unit, and that armor unit gets an extra hex. Usually they're moving 3. Well, it's different. This one's moving 3. Now they can move 4, and they're actually harder to hit. Turret fire, yes. You can have a tank facing one way. And you'll notice that the vertus, I think, the tank front goes right down the vertus. I will slide up and show you exactly what that means in a second, but you can clearly be facing in one direction if you have a turret and shooting back in another direction. So this would tell you you're doing some turret fire. You could be immobilized and you could also be suppressed, in which case you're not going to be doing shooting, but you're going to get some extra defense die. You could also be forced to fall back. Let me zoom in on this tank. So you can notice just looking at the tank, its front faces right down the center line of the two hexes in front of it. So these two hexes are its front firing. And if anybody fires at it from that front angle, it's going to hit the front part of the tank. If they are coming at the tank or shooting at the tank from these sides, that's going to be flank fire, which when I show you the cards, you're going to see how that impacts. And these would be to the rear. This also counts movement. So if I was reversing, I would reverse into one of these two. Or if I'm moving forward, I would move into one of these two and then on and on and on. And probably the hardest thing for me to get used to is the fact that the tank goes down that line rather than down the hex. But they do a nice little reminder because this is also a hex and you need to make that kind of match like a puzzle piece. So first of all, the dice. I'm showing a chart right now, probably in this upper right hand corner here. You've got multiple colored dice, and as you can see by the chart, red much more likely to hit. You even have some double hits on some of the dice faces and a single blank. And then you can see the slightly degrading nature of the colors as they go. You're like, okay, great, I got dice. How do I know which dice to throw when it's time? Well, in comes the card. So you'll have a card. Let's say I had three Panzer IVs on the board. I would only have one card for them. An optional rule would be if I have command points, I would have to place command points on here. So let's say I had two command points on, I would be able to activate two of my three Panzer IVs. So you're like, okay, I go ahead and activate one of them on the board, and I have some options here. So first of all, you can move. This tank can move three. You'll see these shields that are surrounding the tank. The shields tell you what your defensive dice, what defensive dice I will be rolling against whoever's attacking me. Somebody attacks me from the front, I'm going to be rolling a red and a yellow die. And so I would just roll that if they attacked me from the front, and they would roll whatever they attacked with. I'll get to the attack part by showing it on my card here in a second. We would do a roll off, and then you simply will subtract the defensive die. If I were to get this roll where it's a double, where I have the death's head and a target symbol, that means a critical and a hit, I could just with that die alone subtract if my opponent got a critical, the skull and crossbones, or a bullseye, the hit, I could counter both of those with that single die. So as you can see, we go around the shield at the bottom has dice in it or squares in it. That symbolizes my flanks. At the rear, symbolizes if somebody shoots me from the rear. And at the top is if someone had an angle to the top of my tank or if I'm in close combat with infantry. So I've got to be very careful because if we slide down, this is my attack dice and my range. So you can see if I'm in close combat, zero range, same hex, with a tank, I'm going to get one red die and three green. But if I was in close combat with infantry, it would be two yellow and a blue. Now you can see, let's just go to the armor side. Those hexes on the top are representing range and the attack dice I'll use. So if I'm at range one hex, two hex, or three hexes, I'm going to be rolling two red dice against another tank that I'm shooting at, and then they would have their defensive die, which would be set up just like the shields, but on their card. Now, if I was at ranges 4, 5, 6, or 7, I would be using one red die, one green, and one blue. And then you can see if I'm at 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, I'm going to be using a red and a blue. And then the ranges below are for AT guns and infantry. And again, you can see the ranges are a little bit different. and the dice makeup are a little bit different. So if I end up with hits that get through or critical, I'll even do an extra little roll and see if I can do some extra damage, and they're not able to block it with their defense dice, I can take out the tank or immobilize it or whatnot. And all of that is done with a simple die roll. All the thickness of armor, the power of the gun, the basis of the range, all baked into grab this colored dice, and roll them. Just to show you, I will throw in, here's a rifles 41. You can see they can't do anything against tanks at range. They do have a little, they're a little dangerous if they're in close combat with a tank, but then you can see all of the damage they can do for AT guns or guns and other infantry. One last thing to cover. I've placed these cards down. These are formation cards. You have some for the Russians and the Germans. You have infantry formation, you have armor formation cards, and you have guns. You may have a scenario that says you're going to get reinforcements in turn three. And what you'll do is, or what you can do, this is optional, you can know what they are and say, okay, I'm getting X units, whatever, on turn three. Or you can randomize it and just say, hey, I'm going to get some infantry units turn three, shuffle a whole bunch of these random infantry formations, draw one, and then realize, oh, all I've got here is this grenadier platoon, and this is what I'm going to get in this case. Or maybe you were going to get some armor and you picked up a heavy recon section. So, or let's flip this. You can see you picked up an anti-aircraft gun, which is an 88, not too shabby. So we're back. What you just saw actually went and shot a second time. What I wanted to convey was the ease that this system gives you with the cards, the options of the command points, the quick resolution of the dice, which you've now seen, and also little hints of the optional complexity that can come along with the game. So of course we've got this amazing campaign book, which I just kind of flipped through a little bit. So if you're looking for a system that's going to have legs, not only do you have the individual scenario book, but you've got the campaign book. And on top of that, the optional rule with the formations means no particular battle, even if it's the same tiles and a similar setup because of the formations, you may have totally different units. So you've got that playability there. That's one of the big parts of a tactical war game. So when there's that much replayability in a single box with the scenarios, the campaign book, and the formations, you know you could spend a long time with just the base system, and I believe there's more things coming, hopefully, because the system, we'll step the rules off to the side, the system of the cards in conjunction with the dice is, first of all, I like chucking dice. I am not a CRT guy where I like to look up and then over here and then look at this over there, and then what do I got? And then is there step loss? So I don't enjoy the CRTs. I know some folks do. I'm not anti. But the dice chucking and visually seeing right away, whoa, major hits, or that red die got me a blank, and oh, you're going to be kidding me. I was expecting a lot from that red die. But then you're seeing what your opponent rolled, and boom, it's all there. And all of the hard behind-the-scenes math as far as thickness of armor and slope and range, all pre-done for you and then factored in with the dice. You know, you do have a few things that you're going to have to pay attention to, you know, what kind of terrain you're in, because you might get a die. Or there's certain situations, again, where you're going to lose a die. And I didn't bring it over, but that's where the player aid, it's a godsend. Because I'm always sitting there thinking, what do I do here? And just me personally, I'm still not playing with troops riding on the tanks. I know the Russians did it all the time, but there are, for me, a lot of little fiddly rules about when they're getting off, what hex they go into, because you can't have two units in the same hex unless it's close combat. And I did not go into close combat in the closer view. I actually had it filmed and it just kind of devolved into me explaining. And I thought, so close combat, you can get into close combat. When you are, another one more unit can come in and like back you up in close combat. But then when it resolves, they got to get back out because you don't have any stacking. Right here in the corner, yeah, okay, I'll throw a little rules on it that'll show close combat in a nice little snippet. I'll throw that up there. You're probably looking at that now. And hopefully that'll feed you in, because the close combat's good and you're definitely going to want to close with some of these tanks, especially if you got tank hunters. I lean toward tactical World War II games. When I found out this was out there and I had a chance to review it, it was sent to me by Wolfgang Klein, the designer. I was like, yes, definitely, because this is very, very unique with the dice resolution system. And for me, I know this could be different for you, the dice, that the just the clatter of the dice, the tactile nature, these are beautifully quality done dice, and watching them resolve, I get a lot of enjoyment from dice rolling in general. And I usually don't use a dice tower because I want it a little crazy. I want them all over the map, baby. I want them bouncing in and messing with stuff. Okay. I've also talked to you. I have no problem with the facing right down. I always forget the name of it, but right down the middle of a line, meaning that my front two hexes are my front, two single hexes or hexagons off to my flanks, and two on my rear. It just visually still takes me a little bit of time getting used to. It works fine. I think this is the first tactical game I've played that has it. So, what was interesting was I actually thought it might be a lighter system overall because of the dice and the cards. Know this, it's not anywhere near as complex as Advanced Squad Leader. But I believe it's that in-between space, wherever that may land, and this is just for me, it is more complex than Conflict of Heroes and less than ASL, but it fits in there. The dice and the cards are a nice touch because that part gets simplified and then leaves room for these other little caveats and these little side rules. I didn't mention, but you know, mortars or indirect fire happens before the combat phase. So your smoke can get laid in, or suppressive fire can come in before all those actual combat pushes happens. Nice little touch. So there's some little things in here that for me made this mentally brain burning because I would go, dang it, I know I'm missing something here. The card, the little player aid, answered most of those for me. And with the go look at this area based on the index or even the helper card, I could find the answers. And then I'd go, okay, yep, I get a blue die here. And we're off and running because the dice system is solid, very cool, and simple. Bonding with board games and RPGs, if you like tactical games, I think you're going to really enjoy this one.